We're quorate for taking evidence for, but not for decision-making at this point, although I think we will get a fifth member within a millisecond.
Sorry about that.
So, members, what we're going to do is we'll start with the evidence session and we'll go back to the agenda thereafter. So this is to give us an opportunity to hear from the Commissioner for Public Appointments, who'll be talking to us about the representation of women and minorities on the boards of public bodies, also in the roles of chairpersons. The clerk's memo is page 103 of your main pack. The Commissioner has given us a briefing that begins at page 105. There's also correspondence from the Committee for Communities at 113. Other papers, there's a departmental response to the Committee for Communities at 125. And then the response from the Executive Office to this committee is at page 129. And finally, a research paper named Diversity in Public Appointments in Northern Ireland, which was prepared for the Communities Committee, is in tabled papers at page 17. And so we welcome the Commissioner for Public Appointments, Judina Leslie, and also Pat Neeson, who is the Business and Policy Manager to the committee. We welcome you both. And Judina, would you like to make some opening remarks,
please? Yes, thank you. Thank you. And I'm delighted to be here this afternoon. Yes, you'll have my briefing paper, so I can just, in a sense, summarise what, to begin with, to summarise what's in that. Public appointments are not necessarily things that attract headlines all the time, and if they do attract headlines, it's usually for the wrong reasons. But public appointments are of tremendous importance in our constitutional system and in our administration. Public bodies administer the majority of our public spending, so it follows that the organisation should have a very high functioning governing body, and the appointments to those public bodies are made by ministers. That's a correct use of ministerial power. But it is one that must be transparent and accountable. And it is a very extensive ministerial role, and I see the job of the Commissioner as being part of the constitutional checks and balances, which ensures that the exercise of ministerial power is done in an accountable manner. So I have set, as you will see, I have set a number of priorities. And may I say at the outset, you know, I do take really seriously my role as a guardian of the public appointments process. I do think it is very important that the public has confidence that these very influential appointments are made in a way that is without favour, without patronage. And they want to see the best people being appointed on merit. So my priorities, I have set my priorities as one, we need to see more, a better representation in public bodies. So we need to see more women at chair level and at membership level. And that, I mean, the reason for that, the arguments about equality and fairness, they've all been well made. We have equality legislation in place for a long time. So they're all, we're familiar with those. There's also really good evidence now to show that there is a strong business case and strong economic case for ensuring that there is much wider and more equal participation of women in these decision-making roles. So if we have a view of a society that is highly functioning, strong economy, this has to be part, and a good administration, this has to be part of that vision. The other area that I've made as a priority is to promote, and from my role, to promote good governance. And again, you know, I don't need to say to you how important good governance is and what happens, the disasters that can happen when there isn't good governance. And unless we have good governance in our public bodies, we're just simply not going to have efficient public services. So the first, there is a real challenge in terms of, and particularly I'm looking at the chairs of public boards. The figures there, we have 22% of women are sitting at chair level and 78% men. It's a very poor image for Northern Ireland, for Northern Ireland's administration. So we need to do something to really change that. And as the executive has set targets, and you'll be familiar with that, the executive has taken a really bold step and set targets, and particularly set targets at chair level. And there's nowhere else in the rest of the UK, or indeed the Republic of Ireland, or I'm not aware of anywhere at a European level, that has set specific targets to see a better representation of women at chair level of boards. So that's really, that's groundbreaking targets. But again, it's a question of public confidence. There is no point in us, in the government, in the executive, putting forward targets if they're actually not going to deliver on it. And, they're just, from my background as a senior civil servant, to have strategies and not actually deliver on them is soul destroying for the people working on them, and it really knocks public confidence. So I'm very determined to support and promote these targets and to actually see change and to see something happening. So we've done, quite a bit of work within my own office within the last year to try and achieve this. So we've been running a lot of workshops. We call them demystifying the public appointments process. They've been very successful, and we have a long waiting list. I can talk about those a little bit later. I've also made changes to the Commissioner's Code to really put a focus on diversity, to keep it at the forefront of the department's and officials' mind when they're handling this. They have to take some action to really make change. And, doing what was done before is not going to be good enough. Your department has produced a draft action plan to deliver on these targets. So that's good. We've got that to that far. I want to work with the department. I want to collaborate with them. I want to support them. I want to help to promote this. I have to say that my predecessor produced a report with recommendations in January 2014. The executive set targets in March 2016. We have a draft action plan in January 2017. I want to work with the department, but that level, that doesn't show a huge level of commitment. That really is not, that level of delivery is not, that's not going to deliver if we keep up at that pace. So I'm going to work with the department. I have the draft. I'm going to work with them to try and strengthen it and make it effective. But I want the department to understand as well that unless they won't deliver on these targets with that kind of slow level of progress. So there are a number of aspects of the action plan about outreach work, which already, I have anticipated, and my office has been doing a lot of work in that area. I would like to see us, we have the expertise and the commitment to that. I would like to see us increasing that work to do that. And we would be very happy to take on more of that work to really promote public appointments, inform people, engage with people, and train or help people, support people to understand the public appointments process. And that will take, bottom line is we're doing the best that we can very small office, tiny resources. We could do a lot more with a modest increase in those resources. In terms of what we might, what this committee might do, there are legislative changes which have been agreed for a long time, and they haven't been delivered on. It's just too slow. It's too slow for delivery. So again, I would urge the committee to look at those legislative changes and see why there is so much delay in bringing them forward. A lot of the actions in the action plan are left to the responsibility of the public forum, public appointments forum. Whether or not that forum has the authority or the capacity to really deliver on that, I have a question mark on that. The forum meets three or four times a year. Whether or not that can deliver on a detailed action plan, you know, we really need to look at who is responsible for the delivery of the actions which are going to achieve the executive policy which has been set. Yes, and I suppose, you know, what we can do is have a focus on good governance and the pursuit of excellence in the public administration. So the committee will take an interest in what departments are doing to achieve that. You'll see, you know, I've set out a number in my briefing note. You'll see I've set out a number of possible suggestions, but I'm quite happy to take...
Excellent, okay. Yeah. Elena, thank you very much indeed. I think what I would like to do is take a look at probably the current landscape, mm-hmm. the targets, what people mm-hmm. think is achievable yes. better, and also then the powers yes. of the Commission, because mm-hmm. I know there's an issue over mm-hmm. improved mm-hmm. legislation. So in terms of the landscape, you're telling us that the last sort of head count, there were 1,372 public appointments.
Yes.
Which is a significant figure for a country of this size.
Yes, yes.
You're also saying there are around 300 appointments made each year.
Yes.
So that suggests to me there is a significant churn by over 20% of all appointments
yes.
are refreshed annually. So if we look, for example, at the Equality Commission, who find themselves in the unfortunate and ironic position of having an imbalanced workforce in terms of Protestants and Catholics.
Yes.
They will always say to us, but our problem is we're not recruiting. And until people start retiring and we start recruiting, we cannot rebalance. But really, there can be no excuse for rebalancing public appointments if we have over 20% of a churn. So we're sitting at a female's 39% but male's 61% of that 1,372.
Yes, yes.
Are we using the churn effectively?
Well, you've actually got very quickly to a core issue here.
Oh, are we noting
yes.
this?
Because this is what, you know, when I'm looking at our action plan and saying to the department, right, we set these targets. What do we need to do? What do we need to see year on year to achieve these very challenging targets? We're going to see changes of 3%, 3%, and 10% changes. That's if every opportunity is used when a vacancy comes up. And so that's why I've been promoting the idea that we need to use these up. We need to understand that every vacancy presents an opportunity. And we need to understand the figures that we're looking at, a 3% and 10% increase. So I've also asked that reappointments should not be done as a matter of course. You should think really carefully about reappointments, because reappointments, you lose that opportunity to refresh and to bring in new people and to do something about the figures. So yes, there has to be a focus. That churn, you know, only if we optimise it can we go anywhere near achieving these targets. And I don't like to think that they, as the executive, has set targets which they have no intention of achieving. I'm not that cynical. So, yes, and we have to. And what we have noticed as well, is that departments really need to plan ahead. They need to plan succession plan, and they need to think about this rationally and say, these are our targets. These are the opportunities. We plan ahead and we start the competitions. We know how long a competition takes. and we started on time. But we're constantly getting requests for extensions, for delays.
Okay, so there is a target for gender equality in all public appointments, including chairs.
Yes.
And as you say, while the overall split is 39% female, male 61%, for chairs it's much more stark, females 22%, yes. Males 78%. Mm-hmm. So I wonder, how optimistic are you that the target of equality, I was going to say, could be met by the end of the mandate, but when I say that, I'm talking about financial year 2021 and not 5 p.m. on Monday.
Well, laughter is probably an inappropriate response to that. That's a really serious issue, so the targets are set for 2021. How are we going to achieve equality at chair level? That's really, really challenging. And we need to see real commitment to achieve that. I think it's going to be very difficult. I think the department, the civil service, which is responsible for helping and promoting this, I think it reflects really badly on the civil service that we have a permanent secretary group that is so poorly represented. There's zero representation of women. That's a really bad example. And, you know, it does question how the confidence that this organisation will help deliver on these targets. But you're right, Chairman, they are very challenging.
And there's now good empirical evidence and research that says from the private sector,
yes,
that kind of balance that you seek is actually very good for productivity,
yes,
good for the health of the organisation.
Yes, yes, there's very strong evidence gathered at a European and UK level. Which shows this, it doesn't make sense for us, if we're developing a modern economy, it simply doesn't make sense for us to continue on the way we are and that we don't really take this seriously and make it happen.
The other statistic which I think is interesting, but perhaps is in a different way, is the representation of young people measured as under 30s, and of that 1,372, only 4%. Are under 30. Is that in any sense more understandable given the weight we give to experience?
Yes, yes. It is more understandable. Nevertheless, there is scope. There still is scope for involving our young people more, and it can be of benefit to the organisations that we involve our young people more and build the skills there. But on that point, we have developed a mentoring scheme with graduates, young graduates in Queen's, to try and bring them in and give them experience at board level. So, yes, there is work to be done. We're also talking to youth organisations. And it's very good for a democracy and for a society that our young people feel engaged. And given the difficulties that we're experiencing, the more engagement, the positive engagement we have, that can only be a good thing.
Mm-hmm. I personally think it might be more understandable if that 4% figure referred to young people under 30 in chair positions.
I think is across the board.
Across
the board, yeah.
But if we're talking about the importance of experience, then you could maybe forgive.
Yes, yes,
aren't that many under 30s in the top role, as it were. Mm-hmm. I'd like to come on to the powers and the legislation at the moment, but I know Danny wants to come in.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. Thank you, and you're very, very welcome. Happy New Year to you. Just a couple of issues. There is no bar on the number of boards an individual may serve on.
No.
Currently.
No, that's your correct,
so,
yeah.
And you've suggested a review of that, I think.
Yes.
What's your own view as to whether or not the number of appointments should be limited?
Well, I've given this some thought. I think it's undesirable for an individual to hold more, have multiple appointments, hold multiple positions. But not every position is equal. Not every post is equal. So if we introduced it, I introduced a guidance or suggested that there should be a cut-off, a limit of 3. Let's just take that number. It may be that an individual has a number of very undemanding, smaller 2 roles that are and voluntary, no remuneration. Now, that's a different kind of profile than someone who's holding 3 very substantial public appointments. So I probably, in terms of thinking about the policy of this, and I've discussed it with departments, the public policy, probably a cut-off may be just too blunt an instrument. But I'm sending out a clear message that multiple appointments are undesirable. And that's a message then that we can get through to departments will look at that.
So you're kind of coming to a situation where 2 remunerated appointments would be enough on top of any other responsibilities that there might be.
I think that's without, you know, it can't be scientific about this, but I think that sounds, that you know, we feel that's a reasonable.
In terms of the range of appointments, and, mm-hmm. and there are some departments obviously have more appointments than
yes,
that.
Yes.
And I probably should declare an interest that it is within living memory that I had ministerial office and
yes,
therefore had
yes.
some responsibilities.
Yes.
So there you are.
Yes.
And I've been open and honest about that. In your extrapolation of the figures,
mm-hmm. Figures are we talking about?
Or the stats that say
yes, the percentages, yes,
percentages.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Whether male, female,
yes.
Catholic, Protestant, others, all of that. Are there particular concerns within individual departments? Mm-hmm.
No. What we see recently is that some departments who previously would have been seen as being very traditional men's sector dominated by men, that they have actually made really good effort and they've been successful. So I'm thinking the Department of Agriculture has been really successful because it has made efforts to widen out the pool and attract in more women, and that has worked. Some departments undoubtedly are better than others at organising and planning their public appointments. So your question, you know, does it vary between departments? In education, we see across the board we just see the same kind of disparities, whether or not it's traditional or non-traditional sectors, we see imbalances.
But there's no unhealthy pattern of concern.
I can understand why in some areas where a particular position is very specified, where the requirements are very specific. For example, there have been a number in the Department of Finance that have come up where you won't have a large pool. But I would expect to see in housing policy, for example, or in the housing sector, there's no reason why there shouldn't be an equal balance of representation across those kind of areas. So there's a generally unhealthy lack of representation at chair level, and it's across the board.
Just one final question, Chair, through you. Greater promotion of the opportunities that exist.
Yes.
Occurs to me to be one of the significant
yes.
issues.
Yes.
And there, with due respect to retired civil servants and even former politicians, there is this kind of accepted knowledge that such appointments are available or potential for them.
Mm-hmm.
So a wider community, the wider population who would make a significant contribution, actually, because of their skills. They largely remain ignorant about the opportunity that presents itself. How do you improve that?
Well, the department in its draft action plan has focused on that quite a lot and has good ideas about that and about a kind of publicity drive to inform people more widely. That is really important, I agree with you, it is really important. How can we get a wider pool of applicants coming in if more people don't know and understand about public appointments? So that kind of publicity and information drive is really critical, and the department is committing to do that. We've been doing our own work in the Commissioner's office by going out and speaking with a lot of groups. I've done a lot of talks around the country. And for example, some MLAs have invited me down to their areas to speak. And, you know, I'm very happy to do that.
The workshops
themselves, and we've held them not just in Belfast, but also around the countryside. So that kind of work has to be accelerated, increased and accelerated, and the department is committing to do this kind of work. Yeah.
Janina, you singled out the Department of Agriculture for particular
yes.
positive comment there, and I'm just wondering if there's any connection to the fact that the current minister, the previous minister and the minister before mm-hmm. that were all women.
Yes. Well, there's bound to be a connection. There is a connection. Yeah, there's bound to be a connection. But obviously, you know, and just without being too personal about this, I have three children, two boys and a girl. I want this as much for my boys as for my girl. And I want men to support this and help this because it creates a better society and more opportunities across the board. So yes, there is a connection. If you have women in positions, then they help others come on. But really, you know, we're also looking to the men who are in ministerial position to really commit to this as well.
And in terms of those multiple appointments, I'm wondering, is there any research into the correlation between the advertised hours expected of those taking up public appointments and the actual hours worked? Because anecdotally,
yes,
I would certainly meet people in holding public office, public appointments, since they say, you know, if it was 8 hours a week mm-hmm. or 8 days a month, it turns out to be mm-hmm. 12, 13, 14.
Yes, well, I think that is a common issue, and time commitment should be fully explored and explained, and I suppose there should always be a certain build-in of extra into that, yeah.
But it would be another reason to resist multiple appointments.
It is a reason to, yeah.
What about the appointment of political councillors to public boards?
Again, this is an issue that has come up. I set out my thinking on that. The appointment of councillors, there are quite a number of statutory nominations, and quite often it is from local council representatives have their positions held on boards for local representatives. My understanding when that originated, the policy thinking behind that was perhaps at a time when there wasn't, it was a time when there wasn't the same level of political devolved institutions. And so it was a way of ensuring that there was local representation on these boards. I don't think the same argument applies as much now. And what I have seen is that these kind of appointments can become very politicised. Yes, despite yes, the particular circumstances.
Yeah. But circumstances do change.
Circumstances change. But generally, so the rationale behind this policy, I think, has you know, the original rationale has changed. And I do see that it can lead to a very politicised process, which, you know, if we can avoid that, then and there's no strong rationale for it, then that should really be considered carefully.
Okay, thank you. Pam?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. And it's kind of coming to the back of some of Danny's comments, and I suppose just to go back to what you were just speaking about there, the representation that's come from council, that also
yes.
affects the gender and
yes.
the age balance as well, because
yes.
traditionally councils have been mostly older males.
Yes.
So that also impacts.
Younger males as well.
It's all relative.
That's right.
And I speak as somebody who did serve on local council and was only one of two females for a long time out of 19. But I didn't get there. I ended up, I was the youngest and the first, and as it happens then, the only ever female mayor of a particular borough in Antrim. So,
But it's a good role model.
Yeah, but it is, I mean, it is a struggle, but it's also a struggle, I think, with mindsets, in particular female mindset, because we don't push ourselves the way men do.
Yes.
We don't feel the confidence that men demonstrate.
Yes.
People tend to not demonstrate that, so it's an issue within ourselves as well. Mm-hmm. I think we need to follow up with. But just on the back of something Danny was talking about, and you spoke about the multiple appointments. Do you have any statistics or any information on how many multiple appointments out of that total number of appointments there are? And could you even tell us what the most number of multiple appointments there is for any one individual?
Yeah, we do have figures on that.
In the annual report of the Executive Office, we'll have the figures on all that. Now, we wouldn't just have it at hand, but I think one of the appointments had 5 to 7 public appointments at one stage.
It's not a huge problem. It's possibly perceived to be a bigger problem than it actually is. So we will get the figures for you and send you those figures.
Actually, sorry to interrupt you, Dana. We actually have them in table papers, Pam.
All right.
981 people who have one appointment, 149 have two, 27 people have three, and 3 people hold 4 public appointments, and that's from March 2015.
Yes.
So it's a huge tail off.
Yes. And then is there... you speak about remunerated posts and that as well, but do you look at whether these individuals are employed and whether they're, how many hours they're working in their employment as well? Would that factor into any consideration?
Well, not that wouldn't be in those figures, but I mean, an individual is always asked, are you able to commit to the time? So that is a part of the selection process. And in terms of remuneration, again, the higher remunerated posts, the disparity between male and female becomes more acute. So in other words, the higher paid posts are really predominantly filled by men.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Well, final area, Judina, was your powers. You are seeking legislation. It would be useful if you could talk us through what it is you're looking for and what it's aimed to achieve.
Well, we put the department is in receipt of recommendations and has agreed to update the legislation to place the promotion of diversity on a statutory footing. It ought to be on a statutory footing. It's on a statutory footing in the rest of the UK, so that's one thing, and there's no policy difficulty with that. So that has been agreed to, but it just hasn't been implemented yet. And to extend the whole regulatory system to reappointments, and again, it doesn't make sense. Not in practice, that's the way it works, but that statutory provision is not in place, and it ought to be in place, and there's no reason for the delay in putting that in place. So that then one power which is more contested is the power of intervention. And that the commissioner, when sees that it's brought to the commissioner's attention that there's something amiss with the appointment process, would have the power to intervene and say, let's just wait and see and see what this problem is and see if we need to have a look at this process. That would be a useful power. It's one that would not, it's unlikely to be used often, but it would be useful, for example, in a previous competition, one that I audited, the applicant pool was 70-30, 70% men, and this was in an area where there was no explanation for that disparity. So at that point, the department itself should have stopped and said, this is just going to lead, this disparity is going to become more acute, we need to stop, think, and go back out and try and get a better pool. They didn't, it went on ahead, and there was, the appointment list that went to the minister was an all-male appointment list. And so the minister is left with a very difficult decision at that stage. It's too, you know, it's very long in the day. There are a lot of resources being wasted if the minister said, no, I don't like that, go back. Now, some ministers have. But, you know, it is a difficult decision. Much better if intervention had been earlier and remedial action taken. So
am I right in thinking you can engage in an appointment process before it's triggered, and you can come in afterwards with your critique?
Yes.
But you don't have the power
to
come in at the critical point.
Yes.
To say, look, there's 100 applications here, 80 of them are from men, only 20 are from women. This isn't good enough. Start again or do it differently.
That was rejected as a provision.
Why was that?
Deal.
As it was seen as, you know, an unnecessary power for the commissioner to have.
But as you say, if you let it go, you devote time, resource, potentially funds to get to a point where a minister may look at an all male list and go,
This
isn't acceptable because it's not gender balanced.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
It is one that we would like to see revisited.
Okay. Danny, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, just on that point, and I think I can understand reasons as to why there was reluctance to move on that. Because ultimately, the department and the minister, with applying the proper procedures and the guidelines, should and can, I think, be trusted to make the best result. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, merit comes into this as well.
Yes. I think
we can't simply award posts on the basis of any other reason ultimately than merit, I think.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
But I can. What other circumstances would you see that you would see it necessary to intervene in a process? Because it is a substantial. I mean, it is. Would you, for instance, tolerate someone who, at an early stage of a process, had been. Their application had been. Rejected and simply on the basis of that, because simply then you become a charter's sort of basis for appeal, and you can be used and abused. So, what other grounds?
Which would obviously be something that
Well, there is a process
avoided,
in place already, or for anyone who feels disgruntled.
But it may be that there's something significant goes wrong with the process. So there may be wrong dates issued, or there may be something significant in a process that we are seeing difficulties when there's a third party running the process rather than the department, where things are going wrong in the actual with the mechanics of the process. And if that's brought to our attention, and if that is something that that the process needs to be stopped and revisited, I would say in the vast majority of cases, if something's brought to our attention, there's a difficulty in the process, that can be talked through with the department and sorted and settled. So I would see that there's only a small minority, very small number of cases where it would be any intervention would be necessary.
I suppose, Chairman, through you again, the better way to solve it possibly is that the department keep a hands-on approach, particularly for other bodies, outside bodies, and that are given not more power to scrutinise, but at least take more interest
Exactly, that's really important point, Danny, and that is, yeah.
So that something can go awry at that.
Yes, well, I would be very happy to see that, because I am concerned that there is a hands-off approach being adopted when it is handed out to a third party, and we see that they don't have the expertise and the knowledge, and that it is, you know, run in a certain way that isn't the most desirable way, and it is not good enough for the department to say that's not our responsibility, that's the responsibility of the organisation running it.
Thank you.
Okay, Janine, a final question, I suppose, is about your own operation, because you have asked for a modest increase.
Yes.
So it might be useful if you tell us what you've got and what you're looking for.
Very, very little. I have two members of staff, and one is. I have to say, we do a lot with a little, and I have an excellent, first-rate team. And Paddy's works 4 days a week. So we have a junior member of staff who works 5 days a week. So that's the total. We could do a lot more with a modest increase. We're having a good impact already, I believe, with our workshops and our outreach work. And I think we could do a lot more with a modest increase in supporting that. I'm also a great believer in collaborating with departments and pooling our resources, guarding the independence of the Commissioner at the same time.
Okay. So. That's very useful. Thank you both, Pat and Janina. Thank you very much for coming in today. Members, if you look at page 111 of your pack, you'll see some suggestions from the Commissioner, and I just want to run them past you to see whether we would be in agreement. Of saying that as a committee we would look forward to the achievement of the appointments targets set by the executive. If we would like to encourage the department to have a focus on good governance and the pursuit of excellence in its public administration. If we would like to tell the department we expect it to implement the agreed reform of the legislation that Judina was talking about. If we would like to tell the department we would like them to implement its commitment to review the practice of appointing local councillors to public bodies. And finally, if we would like all executive departments to collaborate and work in partnership across public appointments.
I'm happy with all of that, Chair, except could we ask the department for a rationale and an explanation as to why they were unprepared in terms of that additional power that was being referenced. Yes, because I think it would be useful to just know what the logic is for that. But everything else I think is fine.
Okay, and finally in terms of our...
Caroline, I think I'm a bit cautious about taking local government appointments out of things. I think they're... And I know it's a throwback to direct rule and when there was less democratic structure available. But I do think that there are public appointments that are made to a range of bodies that benefit from the participation of elected representatives. Yeah. Not in a majority sense. They don't carry enough votes to... You know, to change it, but I think they can make a significant contribution, and the knowledge that the individuals bring is generally helpful to the work of boards.
I agree, Danny, and just to be clear, we're only asking the department to review the practice of appointing local councillors. And yes, Stuart.
Yeah, just to support Danny and what he's saying, there is clearly a role for local councillors in some. Public appointments because they bring a particular knowledge or expertise, or they represent a wider community in all of that. There's no excuse for a gender imbalance in that, and local government and NILGA should look to see how those appointments are made to ensure both political and gender balance. But just to suggest that there should be less councillors, I think is not a good way forward. There is a representative role for them in certain public bodies.
Yeah, and I think they can also bring to the table in live time a political reality which will stop bodies going off on what ultimately will be wild goose chases or down a cul-de-sac.
Yeah. Okay.
The other thing, members, is do we contact the other statutory committees and suggest that they take a look at what's happening in terms of their public appointments from their department and ALBs?
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah. Well, as is customary, members, having heard from a commissioner, we then seek the views of the department. The officials need no introduction because they're not here. And I think we will have to return to that topic as we return to the top of the agenda. So, members, we have apologies from Cathal Boylan, Sean Lynch, Philip McGuigan, and Richie McPhillips.
Philip Logan,
and William?
William Irwin, yeah.
William Irwin. Okay, thank you very much. Members, in your table papers at page 4, there's a news release from the Historical Institutional Abuse Inquiry. On Friday the 6th, the HIA submitted its report to the First Minister and Deputy First Minister, as was required by the 2013 Act. Now, Sir Anthony Hart is going to formally publish Friday week, 20th of January, in Shaw's Bridge in Belfast. I'm not sure about yourselves. I've certainly had representations from victims and survivors of historical institutional abuse who understandably are almost at their wit's end because they've waited decades, they've got their inquiry, they now know the report is in the department and they're about to get sight of it. And it looks like remedial action, compensation, whatever, is just out of reach. I'm not sure there is action we can take beyond acknowledging how unfortunate the situation is. I also wonder, given we this may be our last meeting, but we may have a number still to come, should we invite Sir Anthony, who frequently came to see us in the stage where the legislation was being drawn up.
Chair, I mean, I've only been here 7 months and I've been lobbied extensively around this issue, and I think it's absolutely heartbreaking for the people who have been working so hard and who have suffered. And I said this when they were in front of the committee, you know, there's an obligation on all of us to try and help, and I think it's a crying shame that we're at the position that we're at. But certainly, I think if we are in a position to meet with Sir Anthony Hart, then we should, and I'm happy to support your proposal.
The other issue, members, trying to think of a way to move this on, and it's speculative because we know very little about how we're going to move forward as a set of institutions. But so we know that by 5 p.m. on Monday, it will be clear whether or not there's a First Minister and Deputy First Minister.
That's correct.
If there isn't, the Secretary of State has made clear that he has a duty to bring forward an Assembly election in a reasonable time frame, but we don't know what that time frame is. So it is possible that disillusion may not come for a period of time after Monday. There will be no FMDFM, so they cannot action Sir Anthony's report. Is there any merit in considering recommending that the report is passed either to the Minister for Communities or the Minister for Justice? If, for example, there's going to be another fortnight to disillusion, and asking them to do what they can for the victims.
I have no objection to that.
I'm open to any appropriate mechanism that allows for the report to be converted into action, but I sadly don't hold out much hope for your proposal, but I'll not stand in the way of it.
I think that the obstacle may be the mechanism.
Yeah.
To get it out of the department.
I'm not sure a mechanism exists.
Mm. Well,
I think we're content to try.
I think we owe it. to the people who have sat many, many times in that gallery.
Over that.
Yeah. Okay, but I think we also need to make clear to Savia and the rest that, you know, while we're prepared to try, we have to manage expectations.
Yeah.
Okay, appreciate that, members. Another issue with regard to HIA is a response from the Health Minister about the scoping exercises. You remember there were the two. There was the mother and baby homes, stroke laundries, and then also the victims of clerical abuse, which was not within the institutions. At page 153, you'll see that Health Minister O'Neill is advising a single interdepartmental group is to be established. It will be co-sponsored and resourced by Health and the Executive Office, and it will be chaired independently. We're also advised it's anticipated the group will be established and research will be commissioned in early 2017, but, quote, subject to the required approvals. Well, apart from the fact it's taken, I think, over 3 years to get to this point, which I think is disappointing, I'm not sure what the required approvals are. So if you're content, we will request further information from the Department of Health.
It's fine.
Okay. We have an invitation from Joan McAlpine, a member of the Scottish Parliament, who's convener of their Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Relations Committee. And this is to a meeting of representatives from EU committees in Scotland, Wales, and the London Assembly, and ourselves. These are committees focused on Brexit. The invite's on page 5 of your packs. And this follows a discussion that I was involved with at the recent EC-UK meeting. And they're proposing that we get together at the Scottish Parliament on Friday the 3rd of March. And the rash stick with me.
Wouldn't like to miss my count.
Yes. The rash. I'm going to keep going. The rationale was that it should be after the Supreme Court ruling and before Article 50 was triggered. And the idea was also that it might be, depending on the agenda, that we would want to say to that the Committee of the Economy or of Agriculture or whatever, this is something for you. And again, on that one representative per party rule. Normally, I would say, are we content to accept the invitation? I think it has to be conditional on
everything.
Yeah.
Events, dear boy.
Events, dear boy, indeed. Next, page 9 of tabled. Correspondence from the Clerk to the Houses of the Erictus Joint Committee on European Union Affairs, advising they've been focusing on preparations for negotiations for the UK's withdrawal from the EU and trying to understand priorities and positions of both the UK and other EU member states. They think there would be value in having discussions with this committee as the closest match to their terms and conditions. Again, in principle, are we content to meet with the Joint Committee on European Union Affairs? Okay, there's a revised invitation at page 6 of your pack to a TBUC engagement forum. It's now scheduled to take place Thursday the 2nd of March at Girdwood Community Hub. Normally, officials rather than members would attend, although if an official goes, there's nothing to stop members, is it?
Absolutely.
No. Yeah. Okay, there's an invitation at page 10 of tables to me as chair to attend the Northern Ireland Chinese New Year Showcase event, Ulster Hall, Wednesday the 25th of January. Any objections? If on the
subject.
Fa choy.
You've got it. Yep. Okay, now here's something that has happened, so we've got a bit of certainty to this. A note of a meeting at the British Embassy in Beijing, at which Tim Losty of the Northern Ireland Bureau in Beijing gave a presentation to a delegation from the Northern Ireland Assembly and Business Trust, which included our deputy chair, Mr. Kennedy. Now, this is page 7. Following that, Danny met separately with Tim Losty on a one-to-one basis. He had a tour of the Bureau. Mr. Kennedy outlined our decision to include international relations as a priority for the session. Andy invited Tim to make a presentation when he's next here in Northern Ireland, and Tim Lostey has agreed. Danny, would you like to say more?
Well, Chair, thank you. I also thank the committee for the opportunity there was to go, because, I mean, it was an informative visit. And clearly the Bureau in Beijing is carrying out very important work. Given the nature and scale of China itself, we were out with the Northern Ireland Assembly Business Trust and had the opportunity not only to be in Beijing but also Shenyang and Wuhan, part of Hubei province, which Ulster University have obviously a very strong link. I think it would be very important and useful to hear from Tim Lostey at the earliest available opportunity when he's back in Northern Ireland, not least because I think there are perhaps opportunities for representative offices or sub-offices in either Shenyang or Wuhan, given that Wuhan is a major city in the middle of China with a population of about 10 million. So, I mean, it gives you a scale of things that Shenyang in the industrial northeast, again, has a significant economic clout. And so whether or not some kind of satellite office or sub-office is possible to extend influence there, I think it would be useful to hear from Mr. Lostey what his view was on that, and simply offer that, hopefully in a constructive way.
Thank you, Danny. Any comments or questions, members? Okay, next it's the proposed visit to Brussels. Members, you remember we had proposed to send a small delegation, one member from each party, to Brussels the week beginning the 23rd of January. Can I just put on record my thanks for the work of our EU Affairs Manager, because Karen Jardine has put together a fantastic draft itinerary. Not just the Office of the Executive in Brussels and our local MEPs, but UK Rep, Irish Permanent Rep, and non-EU reps from Norway, Switzerland and Canada were all lined up for a two-day, fairly intensive fact-finding trip. And there's, if you're interested, on page 11 of the table packs, the full kind of rundown. I have our members in view of where we are. And I also want to give praise to Assembly, our committee staff, because they have not committed, as we sit here, to the expense of a single penny. No flights have been booked. Hotel reservations can be cancelled without cost. So we're not out a penny. And I think that is sterling work. Thank you very much. Can I take it we are unanimous?
Yes.
In postponing indefinitely trip. Thank you. Okay, we are to have
Chair, we should not only thank our staff for the work that we've done, but I think it would be very remiss of this committee to not place on record, at least for some of us anyway, not only our total despair, but our extreme anger at both the preceding Brexit discussions, which you've alluded to in terms of rights to Scotland and other places, very important for the future of Northern Ireland, very important fact-finding mission which you had set up in respect of this committee going to Brussels, all of which has been brought down by both intransigence and shocking incompetence by people.
I'm really,
I want to have that on the record, Chair.
Okay, well, I'm really not keen that this committee get deeply into this, but I have to open it if anybody
Well, has. At the end of the day, Chair, myself and my colleague are here, and one half of the government decided they didn't want to be. And that's their choice, that's their decision. But from my perspective, I know I disagree with Stuart on Brexit, but I'm as committed as any other member, I'm as committed as any other member of this committee to trying to make the best of it for Northern Ireland. Whatever the discussions and the concerns that people have, but you know, the opportunity has been lost in terms of addressing some of those issues in discussion, but we'll come back to it at some point, I'm sure.
Yeah, it will be. too late.
Well, look, I think that's fair enough, and I hope Danny would permit me to say that we believe in devolution and we want to see it work. I think my focus today is on trying to keep this committee alive, and we'll go into closed session later and talk about the next couple of weeks, should we be required to continue to meet. We have a delegation comprising members of the UK Kyrgyzstan Friendship Group coming to see us, but it's now been cancelled in view of the current political situation. Page 10 refers to what the plans were. The current list of committee invitations is at page 12, that's just to note. Draft minutes, members, from the meeting of the 7th of December start at page 17. I ask if members are content to agree the draft minutes of our meeting of 7th of December.
Great.
Arising then, response of the Commissioner for Children and Young People to the consultation of the draft programme for government starts at page 23. Are members content for that paper to be published on the PFG section of the committee webpage? Thank you. We have a response from the Committee for the Economy to the consultation on the draft PFG. That starts at page 47. The response from the Committee of Education is at page 52. You may wish to note the submissions have been published in the appendices of our report on the programme for government. There's a list of outstanding committee correspondence at page 100. That's responses that remain outstanding from the department or for which further information is still required. And I have to say, with some regret, members, it appears when the department send a holding note, they consider that to be a response, whereas we are looking for substantive replies. The committee has requested sight of the North-South Ministerial Council audit report on border-related issues. We did that initially on the 6th of October. We followed up on the 10th of November of last year. We've had a response stating the request was under consideration. That was received 24th of November, but to date, we still haven't received a report. The Committee for Finance has advised of an interest in this report as well, and they're asking it be shared if and when it's received by this committee. Email correspondence to that effect is in table papers at page 13. Are you content, members, that we write the Executive Office to ask the report is finally provided to this committee?
Great.
And in that case, are we prepared to share it with the Committee for Finance?
Okay.
And are we content to request updates on the position of outstanding responses or whether further information is required off our list? Okay. The committee agreed on the 9th of November to initiate the process of compilation of the 2017 report on Assembly Committee European priorities. We agreed to seek each statutory committee's views on priorities for the year ahead, taking account of the fact the UK voted to leave in June. Are members content to request the Executive Office priorities for the year? Chris, sorry, just one.
Sorry, just one. Sorry, I apologise, Chair. It was a phone call, but...
Sorry, I think we're very nearly...
No bother.
Sorry, the question was, are you content to request the Department's priorities for the year ahead to help inform our position? Okay, correspondence. There's a summary of page 143. It suggests that the majority of items on the list of correspondence just been noted. A number require a decision, however. The Executive Office has given a response on pre-approval verification in respect of the Minority Ethnic Development Fund and Diversiton Limited. You remember they contacted us with a query. They didn't feel very happy at that point. Are you content to forward the departmental response to Diversiton?
Yes.
Okay. Ah, yes. We've had correspondence from Mr. William H. Jones of Waringstown Development Association. Lengthy correspondence starts at page 168 with further at page 31 of tabled. It's an individual matter, members, and I would suggest our protocol is that we do not deal with individuals but rather refer to constituency MLAs. In this case, we could also, because there is a complaint against the former ombudsman, send an IPSO.
It's fine. Yeah.
Yeah, as well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you very much. We have a clerk's memo regarding receipt of annual reports and accounts.
Chair, presumably, we're writing back to Mr. Jones outlining that and the course of action that we're able to take.
Yeah, oh, yes, our protocol is that we do not deal with individuals. I think he's already aware of that.
Yes, Chair, I've been speaking to Mr. Jones, so yes, he's aware that was likely to be the decision, yes.
Okay, so there's four arms length bodies, annual reports and accounts are in, page 181 refers, and copies are available in the committee office. Members, correspondence from the Consumer Council at page 32 of table advises us that its annual inquiries and complaints report for 15-16 has been published. If you're content to note the remaining items of the correspondence list, we'll move on with the draft forward work programme. The draft forward work programme begins at page 183. Any comments or are we content to agree? Okay, any other business? If not, we are scheduled to meet again on the 18th of January at 2 p.m. here in room 30.
Round Assembly, Committee Room 30.